But we all with an open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. This is an acasm where resolves are compelled with Apostle Epha Emmanuel. As we behold God's word today, we become the true reflection of His word. You will be blessed.
Some of you is you read so much, you know, you are preparing for that interview. What happens when you don't get the job? Haven't you been in that corner before? Where you wore the tie, you are coming out of the room from the board of interviewers and you already know you will not get the job because something went wrong inside there. And your shoulders that was high 2 minutes ago, now is sunken and all kinds of spirits are whispering negative counsels to you. Is it not that point you turn and say yes to the guy you were saying no to since? Is it not that point you took alcohol and you submitted your will to beer? Is it not that point Satan comes and strikes deals with men? At the point where the things you hoped on, it shook from the foundation. Do I go ahead and share about people who were in loving relationships, everything going well, until that point the brother sent you a text message and say he's not doing again? I don't understand where this relationship is going. The season that follows that disappointment is a temptation. Satan capitalizes on your weaknesses. He capitalizes on the point where those things you held hope on begins to shake. I'm bringing this teaching today because it will be a hope for a generation. Every time that your dreams begin to shake, keep your eyes open. Satan is by the corner. He capitalizes on those seasons. Every time disappointment comes, keep your ears on the ground. There are spirits that look for those moments. They are opportune periods for them because they know you will make decisions that is not the best thing you can decide. It is because all your guards are down. Even Jesus, the devil waited for him until he was hungry, scripture said, and he was wearied. In that point, Satan came and said, if you are the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. Satan was alive. Satan was around. Satan has been in Israel since Jesus was 1 year. Where was he until Jesus submitted himself to that level of weakness? Be careful when things are not working. Be very careful, especially when all kinds of bad news begins to hit you. Be careful where you get negative reports. Keep your eyes open. The Bible says, for we are not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. Be careful when the school fees has not come and the time to close, you know, registration portal is drawing near. Be careful when the house rent is on your neck and your landlord is threatening. The deal of Satan must come. I wish I speak to somebody today who would know. You will know why some of the handwritings of the wicked needed to participate to bring you to the point where you entered. Because all of this mountain experience, glory to God. Yes, you are on the mountain. Satan does not tempt you there. He waits for you to come down. He knows you will not live on the mountain forever. In the valley are many spirits that are waiting for your weakness to capitalize on it. So I began to think of a person who used money to buy jam form. A person who went through the rigors of registration. You know what registration is on campus? A person who put up with all kinds of roommates. What happened to her? Please, if you are with me, if you are getting blessed, can you shout amen? Amen. Every environment has a protocol. Every environment has something called an acceptable behavior. That's what protocol is. An acceptable behavior to either enter or remain in it. The university environment has a protocol. The protocol of the university environment is to abide by the rules that was laid out by the authorities and to study without distraction so that your result can be commensurate with your efforts. Success in that season of your life, and for many people that season is like 4 or 5 years. Success in that season is not money. Success is the notice board. Everybody goes to the notice board to check who are the successful ones in that season. So when everybody are students, the metrics that they use to define who is successful is from the notice board, the result sheet. So those who made their grades in that phase of life, that is what success is. It is just like for a child. Success is not money. Success for a child is the ability to please his parents, to be obedient, to be an example, to meet the desires and demands of the parents. It's a successful child. Of all the seasons of your life, is only one season that interprets success as money, and it is the season of adulthood. If you can hear me, please say amen.
Amen.
But then, in that season, in the point where what is success became result, all Satan needed. I even heard that she was, you know, her first result was, is it distinction or upper credit? Distinction. And then the next result just came out and then had a little shaking. This is what happens when you build your confidence or your hope on anything outside Jesus. The day it shakes, your life will lose meaning. Some of you, all you have now is marriage. You know, you want to kill yourself. You want to kill, I must enter. One day, what if the man shows you he's a man? What if he shows you the true color of the human nature? All you have has lost. Some of you, all you are living for, you just carry your child, you wake up in the morning. I'm advising married people and I'm advising parents tonight. While you are laboring and sacrificing for them, don't forget the yearning and the calling of God for your own life. Because at a point, anything built outside God is open to attacks. And when they shake it, your life will lose meaning. For that lady, what they call success in life was a result in that phase of her life. So they attacked what success is. And immediately life had no meaning again. The person I speak about today is dead. Dead and long gone. And you know the funny thing about it? Life continues. Anybody sitting here who is, you know, putting something on their head, being so dramatic, so worried, I can guarantee you, if you allow yourself to come down with high blood pressure and you die suddenly, life will move on as though you did not die. You will be amazed how soon it takes for people to move on without you. Some of you, you know, a spirit is lying to our generation. Say, it's not that they are taking me for granted. I'll just kill myself so that when they miss me, they will know. They will not miss you. Life will go on. A brother died, you know, sometime around March. And I know the damsel he was courting. They were in a very, you know, intimate, very sweet relationship. You know those kind of Nigerian film relationships. When he died, I lie not to you under heaven. I learned a very serious lesson. It didn't take her 2 weeks. She uploaded another brother's picture. This one is just for, it's an injection for brothers. Just take it and realize. Just realize it. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Keep his commandment. This is the whole duty of what? Man. But the temptation in our world is to build on many things. So today my church is simple and it's not going to be long. But I know Jesus will bless us in the name of Jesus Christ. Saints of God, there is a very intimate relationship between organisms and their habitats. There is a very intimate relationship between organisms and their habitats. A shark is very powerful, but it's only powerful in its habitat called water. If you find a way to lure the shark out of the water and he is brought, you know, to the land or kept on a tree, suddenly you will find that he is handicapped. A monkey is a colossus on the tree, but if you keep it inside water, suddenly all his skills are inconsequential. Every organism was designed for a particular habitat. The success and the ability of the organism to wield its full potential is tied to its ability to depend on his habitat rather. And you see, the challenge is that just the way you see a fish does not argue, does not enter any bargain with a shark you know, rather with a monkey, and then they say, let's meet, and then they set the fighting place on the tree. If that, you know, shark decides by pride and say he wants to go to the tree and teach that monkey that he's not his mate, what will happen naturally is that the day he stepped out of his element, which is water, they were vested power that he can wield on account that he was in his element. Listen. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 4, scripture says, for Satan, the god of this world, it is Satan that rules the sense realm. If Satan ever lures you out of God and you now enter common sense realm, you now say, let's look at it rationally, let's think, you know, logically, you will find how even the Solomon's wisdom cannot withstand the wisdom of that old serpent. If Satan lures you out of your element, you are down. Man was designed to live inside God. It is God that is your element. Your habitat is God. If you step out of God, you are compromised. The same way a fish cannot be successful outside water, if man comes out of God, he is compromised. The monkey is a skilled creature, but he is killed if he remains with his element. The temptation of the ages is to flash many things to lure you out of the place. There are three principal habitations. One is the realm of men, which is the physical world. Number two is the realm of spirits, which is the spiritual world. But there's another place. It's called the secret place. And that place is exclusively for God and anybody who looked for him. If you look for God, he will not step out. He will call you in. If you are searching for him, and sometimes the search for God can be a weight that he puts upon your soul, suddenly you begin to fast. And as you are fasting, you wanted to eat, but something say, press more. That thing that is telling you to stay more, it is a call from the secret place, calling your name and say, come. The being in the secret place, he will not step out. He will call your name. That name he calls, the Bible says, quicken us, and we will call upon your name. You will not know how powerful you are until you enter your element. But unfortunately, we are all born outside our habitat. So you don't know your true potential yet until you enter inside God. That's where you will know who you are. The fish will not know yet that he is a dangerous creature because he opened his eye and saw himself on the land. And he does not understand why he cannot move. He is seeing other creatures, you know. The monkey is even stepping. You know, a monkey can walk with two legs if it wants, right? But if that fish is ever given the opportunity to enter his element, finally he will realize why he has, you know, those fins. He will understand that he can be faster than any other creature on the land. If you can hear me, say amen. Amen. See, I'm trying to build a thought. Many of us, we are like that shark that has never entered water before. This is why your body is full of scars and mark of various collisions with strange creatures in darkness. The lieutenants of darkness are continuing to boast around you because you have not found your element. The place you have been fighting is a disadvantaged pedestal. So the fact that you are fighting there and you are still alive is even mercy that is keeping you. And the things I'm sharing about, it borders around all these common sense ideas, you know, all this, you know, let's be, you know, realistic. And I'm thinking, what do you mean by reality? I lift my hands to heaven, in my heart surrender. I tell my soul again, you are Lord of all. Though the seas are raging, you will speak and tame them. And you will find my rest, you are in control. Everything money can buy, relationships can buy it too. Luke 16 from verse 1. Please, Anakazu, I want us to read it together. It will be projected. There will be some truths we are going to see here. Let's read together. I think we are reading down to verse 9. It's a long reading. Let's read together. 1, 2, go. Unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man which had a steward, and the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. Next verse. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear of this? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. He's about to lose his job. Next verse. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. My Lord is about to take my job from me. Let's continue. I cannot dig to beg. I am ashamed. Next verse. I now know what I will do. That when I am put out of stewardship, when I lose my job, they may receive me into their houses. Wait. He is about to invest his job upon several people. He is about to lose one job, but the last face he had before he lost that job, he says, I know what to do. Can somebody tell themselves, I know what to do? Listen, Ecclesiastes chapter 11 said, cast thy bread upon the waters. And verse 1, and thou shalt find it after many days. He says, give a portion to 7 and also to 8, for thou knowest not what will come upon the earth. In the game of life, your investment cannot be absolutely on one front alone. He says, give a portion to 7, give another portion to 8, because you do not know what will befall the earth. The steward says, I know what to do. He took that one job and see what he did. Let's continue, everybody. 1, 2, go. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors, all the people who were owing, all the people he gave all kinds of, you know, goods to and money to that were yet to pay his master. And he's the only one that has the details. Let's continue. And he said unto the first, how much do you owe my Lord? Next verse. And he says, 100 measures of oil. And he said unto him, take that your paper and sit down quickly and write 50. Cancel the other 50 that is on top of it. Is somebody seeing what's going on here? The guy said, Gaskia, I'm owing 100. He says, cancel it, write 50, that is 50 that you're owing. Next verse. Then he said to another, come on, Anakazo, let's read together. 1, 2, go. And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto him, take thy bill and write 80. Write 80. Cancel 100. Let's read together. 1, 2, go. And the Lord commended the unjust steward. Listen, the Lord commended this steward. And what was he commended for? Let's read together. Because he has done wisely. Tell somebody wisely.
Wisely.
Say it again, wisely.
Wisely.
He says, for the children of... I need everybody to read these following statements. 1, 2, go. Verse 9, our last verse. And I say unto you, make yourself friends of the mammon of what? Read that line again. And I say unto you, and I counsel 1, 2, go.
And I say unto you, make yourself friends of the mammon of
righteousness. That when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. The things I'm reading out for you are written in red. If you are going through the print of your Bible, it was the words of Jesus. Verse 8 and 9 will be my emphasis. The Lord commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. How did he do wisely? In the season where he has sensed that this thing I have now will not always be here with me, he made sure he left a footprint upon several people. He made sure he's not the only one that ate when God brought that breakthrough. He made sure as God placed him in that position, it was not only him that rose. He made sure he pulled other people. He made sure a lot of people will owe him the right, at least the need to recompense this good deed that he had done. And the Bible says the Lord, the master, commended the unjust steward. The average man is sitting there thinking, of course, saying, well, is that not cheating? The Bible says the children of this world are wiser in their generation than the children of the kingdom. And I want to share something. The average righteous man, he has a business, gathers money with sweat and buys products. You know what he does? Gives it on credit to his brothers and sisters in the Lord. And because of his good nature and the whole church fellowship and Brother John, Sister Mary, and all of that, a time comes where he's feeling guilty to even ask them for the money that is his own. He does not know how to tell the difference apart between business and religion. The average churchman carries Jesus' picture and hangs in front of his shop. He does not know that he has pursued Muslim customers with that. He does not know the protocol of the business space. And every environment has a protocol. So this is why he carries everything he has downloaded from church and enters the business world and fails. He fails because he does not know the way to the city. The business world has other laws. It was one of the laws that unjust steward deployed. And they said the master saluted him and said, you did wise. He said in that last verse that I said you should read, that I believe you are pretending like you are forgotten. He says, make for yourself friends of the unrighteous mammon. Some of you is there and say, you cannot serve God and mammon. You know, you are looking at mammon like an enemy. But Jesus just advised you to make yourself friends quickly of the mammon of what? Come on, you see, is this your sign that you don't want to be answering? That's what I used to know, that business world has a protocol. And when you see what I'm sharing tonight, if you pay attention, I won't stay long, like I said, but if you pay attention, please, it will benefit us. The protocol of the business world is, you know, I have seen believers also who are feeling guilty to make gain. You know, they buy a good for maybe, let's say, 1,000 naira, and then you ask them, madam, how much with this good? Then the believers start feeling guilty. How much? If I say anything above this, is like I'm lying. It's not a lie. It's a protocol of that space. The reason I'm giving you this truth is so that liberty can enter your soul. When you go back to the business world, go and conquer it. Because there is a limitation Satan wants to bring. He wants you to feel like the loss. Listen. It's not time to clap yet. The unbeliever that is selling by your side, how much? Said it's 2,000. He knows that the person will want to price down. So if you price down from 2,000, no how, you will still arrive at a place I will make a gain. You started from your righteous price and you say, well, the truth is I bought it 1,000. And the person say, make I give you 1,020 naira. Who did this your behavior benefit now? Because number one, the judge of all will not look at you and say you did wisely. He's looking at you and say the children of this world are wiser in their generation than the children of the kingdom. Now you have written exams. When you wrote the exam, you have heard already. Can you tell somebody by your side, every environment has a protocol? If you break the protocol, tell somebody, you will lose favor. Listen. People now have written jam. People have written posthumously. Why are you are there sleeping and you wake up and say, I dreamt. I saw myself with a bag and I was entering ABU gate. Somebody got up, carried his posthumous score, went to Zaria and was asking questions. Please, do you know anybody who can help me facilitate this admission process? At the end of the day, you will understand the laws that governs the cosmos. And the cosmos does not play fair. That person that went and said, sir, this is my sister's or my daughter's posthumous. She has done well, but I just need you to help us in any way you can. And the lecturer will smile. That help us in any way you can. It's that extra thing that this one did that showed that he understands the way the cosmos works. You are there with your high jam score and the pasted list, and Yakubu was where your name is supposed to be. The reason is that you did not know the protocol of that environment. When you want to enter any season of life, don't be quick to participate. Don't be quick to contribute. Don't be quick to relate with the season. And when I speak about protocol, protocol are not only with seasons, they are not only with institutions, there are protocols with individuals too. No two relationships are the same. You dated Mary yesterday, but you are asking Lydia out now. Lydia is not Mary. So you come with all the baggage from your experience of Mary. You know, there are a lot of people who enter marriage with already an expectation of what they want their husband or their wife to be. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
The source of discouragement and the source of, you know, disappointment is expectation. It is when expectations are not met. That's what disappointment is. Disappointment means unmet expectations. Two kinds of people. There is one category that entered relationship, entered marriage to really learn this person. Who is Shetima? Have you ever taken your time to ask that question? You came from your preconceived notion of him. You are looking at him from a distance and you see him every time he's around here, he's praying. If he comes on stage, you say, somebody shout hallelujah. One day, when you draw close, you now say, yes, I do. You will now find out that he's not always saying, somebody shout hallelujah. Till this day, no matter how much I've preached about it, there are people who continue to maintain the false notion that I am always praying. So they call me and say, sir, sorry to disturb your prayer time. You were sleeping. A masquerade was pursuing you by 2 a.m. So you woke up and you carry your phone and call and believe that me, I was praying, you know, I was just praying. And you just need me to, you know, step out of the prayer small, answer you and go back to the prayer. Expectations. Have you asked me what I was doing? You would have little or no conflict with people when you take your time to study. If you study, like I said, you can study individuals, you can study systems, you can study, you know, institutions. But by all means, never attempt to relate with anything if you have not drawn out the protocol. What is protocol? The acceptable behavior. So for person A yesterday, you know there are people who don't like you calling them so much. Hallelujah. There are people you call, you know, you just call now. After 30 minutes, you are calling again and you say, hello, I was just thinking about you. I said, I should just still call and hear your voice again. Your relationship is already failing gradually. You are already choking her, you know. You are already making him feel trapped. He's scared. Why? I can't have my space again. After another 40 minutes, you call and say, where are you? He say, I'm still at work. He say, because I saw somebody like you crossing the road. I said, that relationship is about to break. Just wait and watch. Understand protocols. And how do you get the protocol? Is when you take your time before you participate, draw out the acceptable behavior as touching this person. Some of us, you don't want to have the discipline to study anybody, yet you want people to accept you the way you are. And accepting you the way you are means that they must study you. And most times, I'm sorry to say, the people who display this level of entitlement the most are ladies. Just say, I know one day God will send somebody. Go if you're not interested, sha. God will send somebody who will love me. Just nobody loves nonsense. You understand? Nobody. I'm serious. Wait, please. See. Wait. You know, my usual teachings are usually, you know, about, you know, ordinations, the realm of the spirit, immortals, and all of that. It is meetings that by now you'll be hearing all kinds of shouts during impartation sessions. But the Holy Ghost told me today to touch issues because many people are about to transit from one level of life into another. So they need this truth. It's not a smiling thing. It is for some persons, you are realizing why that relationship is having many crises. It is because you don't even know who you are dating yet. You have never taken time to say, who is this lady? Who is this man? It is you came with your own preconceived notion. I know he likes to pray. And it can be that of all the things that Shetima likes doing, prayer is not one of it. Anytime he's angry and you think you want to make him happy, you just say, let's pray. You don't know him. You don't know him. You came with your own preconceived notions. And every time expectations do not come true, disappointments. Have you ever been disappointed before? What caused that disappointment is expectations. You came with your own expectations. Imagine how life would be if you studied everything before you took a step. Say the wise man says, look before you leap. There are people that are asking you out. If you take your time, stand outside that relationship. Don't say yes yet. Look at the whole condition. And then you will find out that if you have drawn protocols out, you will know relationships that you should never enter. Let me tell you something. There is the reality of seasons in the lives of men. And when people are doing all of this, you know, emotional based decisions, and then they are just, you know, jumping from one place to another, they are not considering these things. The law of seasons is real. Pastor Onu, come, please celebrate him. Sister, come, you on the white scarf, come, God bless you, celebrate her. I want to show you something now, and I need you to remember this. I also need you to bless as many people as you can with this truth. If you can hear me, please say amen.
Amen.
This is our handsome, godly, highly sorted after pastor with an anointing and a grace that validates his steps. See, he's dressed very smart, smelling nice. Listen. I'm heading somewhere. Pastor Onu is in a season of his life, a phase of his life right now, that if he decides that he wants to meet a lady, he is not looking for a girlfriend. He is looking for a wife. Because the phase of life he has entered, in this phase of life that he is in, a girlfriend arrangement is a waste of his time. He does not have time again for girlfriend and boyfriend. He is a matured man. This lady, although she's even almost the same height as Pastor Ono, as tall as she is, she's not in his season. They are not in the same season at all. If Pastor Ono comes to her, no matter how loving they love themselves, the chances is that what Pastor Onu is coming to and what he has put himself inside is delay because of the incompatibility of their seasons. The season he is in is not the season she is in. He will need to give her maybe 10 years to round up, you know, her secondary school now, right?
Thank you.
Her secondary school, get admission, round it up, go to serve, and that's just a minimum of 10 years. Add 10 years to his age, then you will find where people say that delay happens in their life from. Because you carried your own hand and you went to commit yourself to a season that is not in the same tangent with you. Now you are asking the Lord, Lord, marital settlement. And God is saying, if only your decisions were speaking marital settlement. It is not Satan that is his delay now. His delay is his decision. The decision is now. You will now come to this lady and be complaining that she is unserious. She is not unserious. She is not in your season. Because you are talking marriage, but marriage is not in her agenda yet. Is somebody following me? She is not unserious. This sister too will be talking to him and say this, telling her friends that he's a desperate man. I've never seen any desperate person like that. Everything married. I don't know where he's running to. He's not running. He is in his season. You are not in that season, so you don't understand it. Unfortunately, the devil tempts you. I just walk in one morning and then just see a lady with a long eyelash just pass. Of all the things you consider, you never considered seasons. And seasons are more powerful. At the end of the day, when you are saying, sister, I've been seeing you pass this my street up and down several times, and I have taken my time to observe you. As you are talking, all spirits in Zion, they are looking at you, Pastor Onu, and they are saying, what are you about to do? Were you not the one that told us to settle you by 2022? If you enter here, how can 2022 be a reality? Sisters, hear me. I want to settle down. And you are dating a Yahoo boy. A guy came, you know, with ragged jeans. You know, with a funny hairstyle and dye in different places of the hair as a proof of a great scarcity of the Holy Ghost in his life. Wait and hear me. He comes and he says, for some of you, it's even unfortunate. They didn't even call your name. He just said, and you turn. You turn and you follow. Listen. See. You see, I'll change the... I'll start talking about ordinations now. The things I'm drawing our attentions to can sound like jokes today, but you will make reference to this wisdom. Do you know why there are misunderstandings in many relationships? It's incompatibility of seasons. You are not in the same seasons, so you are not seeing life from the same perspective. And I'm sharing these things because I want to also add, emotions are more powerful than knowledge. And so when you see, you know, a cute girl pass, a handsome boy pass, chances are that you will throw all other instructions, all other wisdom that you have, throw it to the wind and want to gratify the appearance alone. But at the end of the day, appearance is the least of your credentials. You see, for the kingdom, marriage is a ministry. When two people come together, the immortals are rejoicing because they see the potential of what is about to break forth. But in the earth, marriage is for pleasures. When you want to marry, what were you thinking about? If you did not think about ministry and you did not think about destiny, what you married for? You married for yourself. And those who live for themselves, the Bible says they live for pleasures. You know, all the things you checked, all your indices, is the way she talks. I like the way she dresses. You did not know that there is something on your life that will never come to pass until you find your help. The person, and they call her a help, and they position her inside time. They position him also inside time. You will not know who you are until you find the person you are supposed to help. And if you are aligned with the wrong person, you will have no use because you don't know what to help them to do. Have you heard another statement of the wise? When the purpose of a thing is not known, abuse is inevitable. A woman is supposed to be a help suitable. What happens if a woman ends up in a place where there's nothing to help? The man has not found his bearing. Now this sister is trusting God to write jam. And she applied Maiduguri. Very far from Kaduna. Pastor Ono is still asking her out. Then 1 week before she travels, because God gave her the admission, she now says yes. Pastor Onu smiled. What he smiled for is a long distance relationship that nobody, no angel sent him for. He is the one that carried himself and entered. Wait, I am about to share something. As this lady is going to the university environment, you can never be fair to expect that throughout her 5 years in the university, she will never smile to any brother, and she will not fall for the pressure of all her friends who have somebody telling them something nice there. You carried yourself. No, not Pastor Onu. Listen, you carried yourself and put in a season that is not compatible with you. This lady is now on campus. She is now feeling guilty because there is somebody who is in her season, who is speaking her language, who can relate with her challenge, and who they are living life together with. And she is hanging out with that person and hiding it from him. Because even for her too, this relationship is a disadvantage. There are many people who will leave these meetings and just know that I'm wasting my time in this thing. Go and trust God for your season. You know, I think I've kept them standing for too long. Please, and take your seat. God bless you. Number two, we do not know how to acknowledge transitions. We do not know how to acknowledge transitions. Please take my advice tonight, because it will remain important for many years. A lot of people don't know, you know, why they continue to work hard in a thing, labor in a thing, once that thing is about to be fruitful. For some reason, they will not understand why. They will find that with their own leg, they will walk out of what was supposed to bless them. People continue to point to people from distance and say, we were, we used to be. To acknowledge transitions in the lives of people is one of the greatest ways, you know, to sustain breakthroughs and sustain favor. How do you acknowledge transitions? Yes, we are born at some point as age mates, but we would never, and we were never age mates. Life over time will categorize us into cadres and into different levels. And your seasons of elevations will not happen the same time. Although you were in the same primary school together, but one person will get admission before another. Although you were sitting in the same role in children's church choir, somebody will get married before another. Some people will get jobs before another. So your mate can become your boss in life. If you can hear me, say amen.
Amen.
If you have acknowledged these facts, this is how to save breakthroughs. The challenge now happens. Brother, come, both of you. Please, let me show us something. Take these two brothers to be friends, you know, grew up together from childhood. Please climb so that they would see you. They were friends from childhood. You know, they did everything together, very, very into themselves. This brother, by the orchestration of time and chance, was now, you know, given the opportunity to maximize one opportunity, and then he, you know, became a politician. Not even a big politician. Let's say he's a chairman. This one continues to complain that, see, person, we even drink Gary from the same cup together yesterday. I'm calling him now. He doesn't want to pick my call. Pride in him will now say, who does he think he is, self? Then you turn and walk away. Most of the relationships that are fractured, most of the destiny relationships that are truncated, they were truncated because one person feel undermined, one person feel belittled, one person feel like, what is the other person feeling like, self? And mind you, when you need something, you humble yourself. Please pay attention to the things I'm about to share tonight. If you have realized that I don't have mate in life and I don't have anybody I'm competing with, the day you heard that this brother has become a chairman, you will accommodate a provision in your mind to switch the mode of your friendship from person that we drank Gary with. If you don't associate with him as chairman, the office of him as a chairman will reject you. And unfortunately, he cannot still remain that your close friend again, because the new realm of politics he has entered, there are new associations in that place. And so the way for him to save his relationship and maximize this is when you find other people saying Alebiaka chairman, you too, you will come and you will hail him. Let him tell you that, Haba, my guy, don't be like that with me. Me and you, we are different. And if they ever tell you like that, never fall for it. Continue to pay respect. The door to that office will forever remain open to you. Because every time he hears that you are the one, let me tell you something. A man is designed in a sensitive, you know, mode. A man respects everybody who are above him. He loves the people who are below him. He fights anybody that competes with him. Anyone who claims equality with him, he fights them. You don't know where the relationships get fractured from. It starts from the point where you have refused to acknowledge his transitions. You are best friends. You call her in the night. Now she's married. Oga, a man and a woman, can they still remain best friends like that? You didn't know how to acknowledge transitions. So you find the relationship that, if only you knew how to acknowledge it, that relationship should have continued. One, you will give space because you know she's now a married woman. She used to be what you call bestie before. Mind you, I don't support that. I don't think another person's husband can be your bestie. I am very serious about these things, please. Now she's married. And you still want to call, you know, by 11 p.m. as you used to do before and crack those dry jokes. Now you are cracking the joke and she's not laughing. And she's saying, is there any other thing? And you say, so because she's married, see how she's feeling. That's why I called her the other day. You need to hear the way she was speaking to me condescendingly. Yes, it is transitions. You have not been able to acknowledge it. The chances are that many of us, you have already lost some friends so far. But don't lose more. When people are progressing, don't be expecting that you want to go and test to see whether they will change. They are supposed to change. The new realm of association, the new demand, the new challenge will alter the terms of your friendship. So accommodate the new point that you know that this person might be actually busy. You call him once, call him twice, he does not pick. You that need him, you now block his number. Have you seen ladies who are very, you know, emotional, very funny in relationships? You, by yourself, call a brother, you know, call him, call not a brother, whoever you're dating, call him, didn't pick, call him again, didn't pick. Then in your mind, you say, he's going to call back, so I'll block him, he will regret, he will not be able to get me. The fact continues to be, we must acknowledge transitions. And as God continues to lift men, if you are wise, it is one of your friends that God has lifted. If you know these things, there will be no competition, no enmity, because you will be happy for his rising. And if you know how it works, thank you, God bless you. In Esther chapter 2, scripture said Esther had to soak herself in fragrance and aloes for 12 months just so that she can pass before the king. That was the protocol of passing before the king. She already understood what to take. I will not have too much opportunities. I will only pass by him once. So she prepared for 12 months, soaking herself in fragrance. 12 months so that you can pass before somebody for only 10 seconds. 12 months preparation. In Genesis chapter 41, I believe, Joseph had to shave his beard before he appeared before Pharaoh, because Egyptians hated beards. Egyptians don't keep beards. So he understood that if he enters the palace without understanding the protocol, it can become a point of disfavor. God had to become man so that he can reach man. God honored the protocol of the physical world, that it is a world of men. So God obeyed protocol, became man, so that he can come to men. But for many of us, we are aspiring and we are hoping and looking at things that we are not ready to pay the price for the necessary level of transition to meet what that environment demands of you. So if I ask us now, everybody seated here, you know, what is our hope? What's our aspirations, our goals? It will become clear to us, you know, very soon. There are places that the arm of the flesh was supposed to fail. There are places only another can hold you and carry you there. But for many people, you don't know the last time in life that anybody blessed you. Everything in your life, you must sweat for it. Anything you have is because you sorrowed and you went through the rigor and you got it. It's a very negative report card so far. Currently you are very arrogant. You are still saying you don't care. They should go to hell. You have to care. It's a world of men. One day people will talk about you while you are not there. And what they'll be deliberating about, they'll be discussing whether you should rise, whether they should consider you, whether you should be the one to be given that opportunity, and you will not always be there. those of you who are currently sustaining those attitudes, you know, I don't care. Go to hell, everybody. I don't need anybody. You need people. You really need people. You will come to points in your life where your own strength will fail you. And as at that point, you must subscribe to the wealth of relationship. Today, this is all I feel like, you know, presenting to us tonight, basically around these issues, around these truths. You know, a lot of us, some of us, you know, it could be some of our associations, some friends, some neighbors here and there. Somebody just got admission, you know, supposed to go to school. You called him one day, you know, 2 days, he's not sounding well. You too, you just, you know, there's something they say in house. I say, I'll just shari him. You don't know that time and chance happens to them all. At the end of your life, they will show you the scripts, and you will see that if you would have maintained relationship with so people, there are many junctions in life where you would have never been confused. Because for everybody's life, there was an intelligence that made that you will always have a wisdom for your bailout. But many people focus on their own effort and they forgot that the blessings of God will come from God through men to men. There is no blessing that will come from heaven and land in your front. Every blessing must need a material medium to come to you. What happens when you have not intelligently, you know, deciphered the way and the protocol around men? Yes, we love God, but tonight we must decide, I will love people. I will love people. Some of you, you will do good today. You will not be alive when they'll be paying that good. It was Jonathan that did good to David. He was not alive when David was saying, is there anybody in the house of Jonathan so that I can do good to him? Some of you, your children will be before one board one day and somebody will be seated and they will ask for names. He will call his name and somebody there will smile. He will remember. He thought he would never see you in life again, but he met your seed. Some of you, the actions of your parents are padlocks that have closed many doors. Say, well, who are you? You say, I'm Tunde. Tunde who? Say, Dogon. I say, Dogon. Is it a man that attended ABU around 19? You say, he might be him. And they say, okay, go, we'll get back to you. Give a portion to 7, give another to 8. You don't know what will come upon the earth. And let me tell you something as we conclude and pray. The limitation of, you know, the arm of the flesh is very vast. Let's say you have read. I'll use my illustration for a student. You've read and you have prepared. You have crammed all the materials that there be. There is a limitation to that, your own work. The arm of the flesh will fail. Because after your preparation, if by any means you became sick suddenly, although the things are in your head, you will not be able to take that exam. Now, another brother went to NDA, you know, went through the rigors of 5 years of, you know, hard labor, endured it and passed out, and was going from Kaduna to Enugu to go and celebrate with his family. Somewhere around Kogi, the car had a small screech, had a small accident. Nobody died except him. Listen. You see, in the equation of success, there is a place for hard work, but there is also a place of dependence on a sovereign creature. Because when you are done with your own work, when you are through with all your own preparation, spirits can hack you down. Okay, let's say you did all the preparation. Your wedding date is, you know, 23rd. You by 20th, you are already staying indoors so that your skin tone should be the best on your day. So sun should not touch you for the next 5 days. You were watching the things you are eating. You don't eat oil. All that your carefulness, you can sleep and not wake up. And that one is the motion of spirits. So outside your physical caution and precautions, spirits can make move that your precautions cannot help. You can write exam and then your script is missing, yet you knew what you wrote. You see, the things I'm trying to say is that there are many ways for spirits to play this thing out. And if they see you, you know, there's nobody that is funny to them like a man who thinks he knows what he's doing. No, you are just taking your time. Somebody says if you want to cross the road, you know, you look left, you look right, you look left again. Then you say, you know, then you hasten and cross the road. In the evil day, you will do all these things. And you will not know where the spirits found the crack from. And so tonight my call is one. I'm calling on people to abandon trust in themselves. Don't build anything outside God. And it is not also a call for mediocrity. I'm calling that men should first find relevance in God first. Every other thing can be built on that foundation. I started my discourse by talking about the lady who took her life just because results did not come out well. If only she knew that there were many, many people who did not have excellent grades on campus but came out to the other phase of life and became, you know, top CEOs and became very successful. But because your life was built around a foundation that cannot hold ground. So tonight I'm inviting everybody here who have one or two areas that they are depending on outside God. I'm calling you again to look up to the hills from whence comes your help. For somebody who is feeling, you know, belittled, feeling frustrated, feeling like nothing, feeling worthless, drawing, you know, reference from trying to build your life around something that is not God. And because those things shook, now you don't have, you know, any feeling of importance anymore. Please, I'm calling on us tonight. Take your time. Please don't get distracted. Just pay attention. Take your time and x-ray the things that matters in your life. Take your time and check it out. And be sincere with yourself. Honestly speaking, if those things are removed, is God your true foundation? I used to love ministry so much because I believe I was born for this. But one day the Holy Ghost asked me, if I ask you to stop ministry now, what do you have? It was in an attempt to answer that question that I realized that I have been so busy doing the work of God that I have not worked with God. So if they end that work then, my life would have been empty. So he was trying to make me go back to the God that I'm doing this work for. It's been a while he heard my voice. It's been a while that I went to pray, not because I wanted utterance or I wanted revelation. Now look at why you pray. Pray because there's another need. Pray because you have another meeting to go and minister. You pray so that utterance will flow, so that anointing will flow. All of this prayer is just for selfish reason. You never went there because of the person. And every time you come, he's just looking at you again. Okay, what do you want? Yeah, Lord, I pray. And he knows all you want is just your house rent. Take it. And like play, the day he gave you, you left again. He does not see you regularly again because you are busy chasing after the wind. The relationship you are asking for, if he gives you, will he see you again? Some of us, the only reason why God still has your attention and the only reason why God has not answered your prayer is because he wants to be spending time with you. He saw what happened to you when you were praying every night because even though he's fake. Even though he's fake, he still like it like that because that is the only way he will be getting your attention. And now you know why he continues to allow afflictions to come your path, because that's the only time he hears your voice. If everything is going well for you, he never sees you. The immortals don't hear your voice until there's commotion. That's when the only time you fast is when there is an attack. And so how do you think God will draw such a man to himself? He will fill your life with afflictions. He will make that every day you will have a reason to run before him. Mind you, the bread he gave to our fathers of old, he called it manna, and manna is picked daily. He wants men to be relating with him every day. You cannot carry manna and keep for tomorrow. You can't avoid him. You need to be interfacing with him every day. And so the system of the cosmos is to give you enough that will make you leave God for a while. and the system of the kingdom is to give you only as much as you need to look for him tomorrow again. Two systems clashing. So he says, give us for this day our daily bread. There is a bread that is for only today. Tomorrow you still go and meet him again and say, you who is my sustainer. And every day he's enjoining fellowship with you. It was the psalmist that said, it is good for me that I was afflicted so that I will learn your status. Many of us don't know that it's not every affliction that comes from the enemy. There are many afflictions. Do you know one of the character of a deity? Gods have one particular attribute. Every time their loyalist begins to rebel, begins to turn their back on them, they allow affliction to come for them. Even Adonai used that formula. Every time Israel disobey, a Gentile nation will come and carry Israel and take them in captivity. And inside affliction, they will remember their God and they will call on his name. Could it be that that delay is just God trying to call your attention again and say, time is not a challenge. It can look like your mates have gone ahead of you, but I can put 10 years in 1 year for you. I just need your attention. Your attention is more important to God than those breakthroughs. As a matter of fact, let me tell you one truth. Your breakthrough does not take God anything to achieve. 1 minute is enough for your life to change forever. The cattle on 1,000 hills are his. But God continues to check. The Bible says he checks the thoughts and he tries the reins. It is a God that studies tendencies. He sees what you can become when he gives you what you are looking for. And so you can be praying today and God is saying, but my son, the only reason why I cannot give you this, the way out of my house is the prodigal son came and said, give me my own part of the inheritance. What happened as he entered his hand? He left the father's house. I have yet many things to give to you, many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them yet. The labor of a man is to build capacity. Win the attention of the immortals. Win that argument. Let them continue to argue that we are not sure he will live if you give him. Pray until one day even Michael will get up and bring counsel to the courts of elders and say, this one can handle wealth. I saw what he did with the last 10,000 we gave him. This one can handle wealth. You say that the bread of the poor is in your hand. You say you are a kingdom financier. Yet the little they gave you, you were not faithful. They consider tendencies. They check who you are in the secret. And they are looking and saying, if we give this thing, this can become the source of the greatest failure that you have ever recorded. And so tonight, God is still calling men and saying, can you love me? Can you give me your attention again? Can I become number one? Many things have taken that place, but tonight you can come back again. You can come back. It's possible to come back. You can say, Lord, take that place again. You are the only one permitted to sit on the throne of my heart. It's not academics. Academics can fluctuate. It's not money. Resources can fluctuate. Only God can sit there. It's not marriage. A man can fail you. It's not even ministry. Ministry does not have the capacity to occupy that place. When was the last time he heard your voice? When was the last time the immortals heard you making obeisance to the king? When was the last time you came for no reason? When was the last time you came just because he is God? No prayer requests. I just came to enjoy your presence, Lord. When was the last time you called him Father? When was the last time he embraced you? I have this one thing against you. You have forgotten your first love. Remember how you used to be with him, when you used to shut the door and just play worship song and lie down on the ground and roll. Remember when he used to embrace you, when you heard his voice and you cried? What has happened to that? Remember those years when nothing matters. Remember those years when nothing matters, only God. What has happened? Sister, remember how you were before you got married. Remember what it was like before marriage. Now you are so busy, you don't even have time to say thank you. Brother, remember how it was before the job came. How have you become so busy? The only reason you pray now is to bring another petition, and it does not have your attention anymore. What can separate us from the love of God? What? In the next 2 minutes, can you just tell him, I love you? It's been a while, he heard that. It's a long time. I love you. And let your heart be clean as you say it. Today I did not come asking for anything, Lord. I just want you to know that I am grateful. I love you. Father, your prodigal son has returned home. This is me again. Father, your long lost daughter has returned home. I just want to say thank you. Thank you. You wandered away from home for many years, and your father never left you. He sent his ministering angels. They were the ones that stopped that accident. They were the ones that made sure that malaria that killed other people, you got up from the sick bed again. He knows one day you will come back home, and so you have never been alone. I will never leave you nor forsake you, says the Lord. In your unfaithfulness, he remains faithful, ever faithful.
I spoke the words you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me.
Anakazo, is this the experience you have with Jesus?
Chases me down.
Listen to me, please, before we go. Just give me your attention and a cousin. Listen. One of the strongest principalities in our time is lust. There is nothing strong enough to overpower lust except love. The provision in the kingdom to bring lust to his knee is love. These three will abound: faith, hope, and love. There is also, you know, some inventions in darkness. To every expression of faith, there is fear. To every expression of hope, there is worry. And to every expression of love, there is lust. They made all these things to resemble these, you know, virtues in the kingdom. The only thing powerful enough to overcome lust is love. If you are struggling with lust, you just need the love of the Father to shed in your heart. You will find what is strong enough to walk away from that temptation. Love. That you have loved something above any other thing. You can love, and love can make you stand under rain, and the rain is falling, and you cannot feel the cold. Love can give you a jacket. It is love that makes you to make excuse for the person that is hurting you. Love can make you a superman. The fire will burn and it will not hurt you. It is love that has given you this ability to withstand it. That thing that love is doing, it can do other things. Love can make you look at lust eye to eye like this and say no. It is something inside you. It's love. How can these chains fall from my hand? Lord, how can I overcome masturbation? Look for love. If you find love today, you will walk past anything. How can I do this great wickedness against God? A man who is conscious. You can be feeling intimidated. You can feel insecure until you subscribe to love tonight. When love is shared in your heart, you will know. You will know I am the child. I am the son. I am the daughter of the master of the universe. You don't need any endorsement from anybody. My sense of importance is streaming from a realm beyond this. So nothing can stop it. Tonight, as we come to the end of our meeting, just search your hearts and ask the Lord to give us love. Lord, put love for you in my heart. Put a love, a genuine love for your presence, for your agenda. Put it in my heart. Make that your quiet prayer. Help me to love you more.
Dance with me, oh lover of my soul, oh, to the song of all songs. Romance me, oh lover of my soul, to the song of our song. Behold, you come over the hills, upon the mountains. To me you run, my beloved, you've captured my heart. Behold, you come over the hills. Oh.
to me you would run. My beloved, you've captured my heart.
Anakazo, can we sing it together?
Would you dance with me, oh lover of my soul?
Before we go, the way you call, you know, your husband, your wife, your lady, your man. Hello, good morning. Have you eaten? How was your night? Is God that real to you? Do you speak to him knowing that he has emotions? Do you speak to him knowing that he also has, you know, realities that he expects from this relationship? Are you even conscious you are in a relationship? Do you know that you are dating God? Do you know that there is a relationship that requires some demands? You say, I love you to everybody except God. Then you go and sleep. You sleep. All he needed was just, if the fact, don't say thank you. Don't even thank him for anything. But just remember that there was somebody like him. And the most lonely member of the Godhead is the Holy Spirit, the one who is supposed to be your closest person. That your husband and your wife you are putting on your head, when you close your eye to sleep, your husband and you have divided. It is that same Holy Spirit that follows you to your dream again and stay near you in the dream and make sure that even in the dream realm he is still close to you. He is the one you are ignoring. The Holy Ghost that knows all your secrets and is the only one that does not condemn you. Look at the little that men know and see how they are behaving. The Holy Ghost knows you in and out, yet he believes in you, and yet you are not giving him attention. You shout his name anytime you want fire. Holy Ghost fire. And you think he is fire? He's a person. He is a person you have ignored many years. And he's a person that continues to follow you like a zombie, hoping that one day you will call his name. That was what the Songs of Solomon was all about. It was a way of animating the relationship between God and man, like a relationship between a man and a damsel. Showing how a man is yearning for the love of a lover. That is how he was animating the love between God and man. He says, I hear the voice of my beloved in the field. My beloved calls me. When was the last time your ears heard his voice? Has he whispered your name of late? When was the last time you heard Selena? Oh, you are so busy running from pillar to post. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Because if any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. There is a potential for us to love the world. It is a tendency factored into the natures of the cosmos. A man can be made to love many things. But he says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul. Love him. Give him all. You know, when he appeared to me, he didn't speak a word. I just saw him standing in his glory. He was just looking into my eyes. And from his eyes, there was so much love. I was crying. I cried in that encounter till I woke up. inside his eyes is love. I was feeling unworthy to be looked on like this. No human being has looked at me with that kind of attention before. It was a look that was checking all my parts. He was just looking. Have you tested that love before? Komina na kane ya Yesu, komina na kane. This is your response to him. Na Yesu, komina na kane. Yeshua HaMashiach, Komina na kane. Yeshua HaMashiach, Komina na kane. See, I finished a retreat recently. I woke up one morning, very early, I think 3 a.m. I woke up. Please pay attention. I lie not to you under heaven. I woke up and I saw a being standing by my bed. Not in a dream, in the three-dimensional world. He was standing by the bed and he was looking white from head to toe. The white is not a color. The white is like smoke coming out of him. Pure white. And he was just looking at me. Fear gripped me. And then he turned as though he wanted to leave. And I began to feel, you know, intimidated and lonely. I started desiring that he remains because there was a joy his presence brought. So he plucked one feather, he removed one feather and kept it under my pillow and smiled and walked away. I did not know the kind of rest that man can enter until I tasted what the atmosphere of that being brought. I was so happy. I have never been happy in my life like that. I got a taste of what man, live in your atmosphere, live in your habitat, come out of the world. Man was designed to live in God. It is only Satan who should live in the world. The Bible says, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, because the devil now lives amongst you. Are we supposed to live in that place they have caused? Live in God. The Bible says, for in him we live, we move, and we have our being. Live inside him. I saw the feeling that I got when they came and they stood around me. So I wondered what it would be like if that was my perpetual residence. Little wonder in Psalm 91. He says, he that dwelleth. It's not in the realm of the spirit. It's that third place I told you, in the secret place. Live there. Stay there. Make there your perpetual habitat. He says, he that dwells there, he will observe something about his life. He says, he will abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Are you the one that visits? You enter on Sunday only. Talk to God and say hi and you run back out. No wonder there is sickness. There is all kinds of stagnation. Go back to your house. You are that shark that has been living on the land. Go back to the water. Don't fight on the land again. You don't have power to win there. Go to the realm where your powers are. Your true victory is in your habitat. Go back to live inside God. Go back to live in Adonai. Your address is God. The name of the Lord is a strong power. A man can run into God. He says the righteous runneth into him and they are saved. Go back and live inside God. Come to the end of our meeting today. This is how the Holy Ghost chooses to move with us. I want you to be intentional about building your love life. Decide when you leave this meeting. Say, Apostle, when you see me next week, you will know I live in the secret place. Make that your perpetual residence. You will find your true potential inside your habitat. You don't know what you are capable of. There are many things in your body. You don't know what it is meant for. enter your habitat. You will know what those your hands are for. You think words are for discussion. You will know what words are for when you enter your habitat. When you say things, they alter the foundation of creation. You can modify things with words. You don't know the use of words yet. Go back to your habitat. Let's all return to our place of strength. Man was designed to live in God. You are like a scientific calculator in the hand of a market woman. She don't know how to use you. They are just doing mass, 15 error plus 75. You are supposed to be solving complex equations, but you are in the wrong hand. Go back to your habitat. Can somebody say to themselves, I'm going back. Come on, say it again, I'm going back. Make it a conscious effort this week. I'm tracing my feet again, I'm going back. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, where it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you.
Glory to God! We trust that you have been blessed by God's word today. Well, you can follow us on Facebook at www.facebook.com/anacastlemissioninternational.ami or join us